Hello. Thank you very much, Anselm, and also the HKV for this invitation. So the title is Europe, Racialization, Coloniality, the Problem of the Present for Future Scenarios. And what I want to do is departing, as was said, and also publish this introductory in the materials. I want actually to talk about life, death, agency. Of course, the point of departure is 1915, is Dubois, but I want to come to the refugees and to think what and how to actually understand these conditions and also to understand Europe, but specifically death and life. So, in the way why I depart from Dubois is because in the text that was written just 9 months after the First World War, it said that the First World War is actually a war of race. So it's also said that in relation also to others who were reading Dubois afterwards, like Franz Fanon in 1961, practically said that Europe is literally, and I repeat what is already published, Europe is literally the creation of the third world. In relation to this, it's also clear that others who were reading, and especially Franz Fanon, he's saying because of this fact that Europe is literally the creation of the third world, the wealth of Europe is the outcome of plundered wealth from the underdeveloped peoples. So that means it's practically also the consequence that Franz Fanon is exposing, that when what he's saying, and I quote, when the head of the European nation declares with hand on heart that he must come to the aid of the unfortunate peoples of the underdeveloped world, and underdeveloped like this, we do not tremble with gratitude. And others, like Ann-Laura Stoller, is saying, of course, this, how to read this kind of sentence? This is not neither a stubborn ignorance nor a sudden knowledge. On the contrary, it reflects on the conceptual processes, academic conventions, and affective practices that both stimulate and elude recognition of how colonial histories matter. So this is the point of departure and where I want to go. I have 4 points and I want to talk about them. The first one is how to further expose the relation between biopolitics and necropolitics. The second, the consequences of this relation for the conceptualization of life and death, that I said is my point of departure. Third, visibility and humanity. Four, and finally, the status of the body in the relation of the most subtle differentiation between biopolitics and necropolitics. So, the first point. One of the first slides is here. It will be just from the text and why it's this description, very dry, what deading life or deading means, is because in order to expose the relation between biopolitics and necropolitics, I made a departure. Of course, I have to go back to biopolitics, though my interest is necropolitics. And it's a book that was written in 2013 by James Stanescu, actually a text, to be more precise, with the title Beyond Biopolitics, Animal Studies, Factory Farms and the Advent of Deading Life. So this is why the deading life as a new kind of notion is described here, at least how the vocabulary says. In this book, or in this text, he's definitely going back to biopolitics and is saying something that is also part of not only my research, but many, that practically in the time that we live, this days, these years, but definitely after 2001, It's necessary actually to historize biopolitics. Biopolitics is not enough for understanding neoliberal global capitalism. He is also making Stănescu a relation to Foucault that himself insisted on the historicity of the present being at the center of producing our philosophical concepts. So this historization is one of the points, and yesterday it was also some of the speaker, at least one, made this and the point, we have to go back to history if we want to understand what's going on today. But the outcome of also these processes of historization is the work of Giorgio Agamben and other known name Roberto Esposito, who actually talk and take this biopolitical, for us very important, but he developed something differently. He developed a thanatopolitical. So the thanatopolitical condition of biopolitics under a strong influence of Niklas Luhmann, as it was revealed also by Stănescu. So let's see what we have. So he's talking about thanatopolitics, but I want to talk about necropolitics. Though Stănescu say Agamben and Esposito, as both, have greatly added to our understanding of many forms of violence, and they did it in their work, they risk removing the theoretical specificity of what Foucault called for. Stănescu contends, I quote, "While we need an examination of biopolitical thought to explain how the thanatopolitical is built upon human exceptionalism, we also need a demonstration that the logic of the biopolitical is actually not enough to grasp the horrors that are going on today, and they are going beyond the biopolitical." For Stănescu and for us, now making this reference, the important thing is that the human is not a category that exists outside of political contestation and ontological battles. Rather, the human is produced, and it's the site of great struggles, violence, and hierarchy. And the human comes to name the category of beings we seek to protect and foster. And as such, the idea of human exceptionalism can only be understood as related to the concept of biopolitics. But we know that this is too less, and even more, to be even more precise, again, I repeat, so the development, yes, toward thanatopolitics, but the interest that is from my side and others who are working with this is actually necropolitics. Namely, we see a process of constant dehumanization in the refugee camp, because there is where I want to come, and actually I want to talk about the refugees. And therefore, biopolitics, I argue, it's only the politics of life for the Western world. So for this world here, practically for us sitting and listening to me and I speaking. As the refugee camp is not a site of humanization, but of dehumanization. It's not enough to make biopolitics therefore the central point of analysis. The point is that this dehumanization brings different ways of thinking about life and death. And this is pertinent for us, though we are sitting here. When it was reported that in August 2015, the situation of the islands of Lesbos and Kos afterwards represented a systematic dehumanization, it was said in the media that it was no word to humanly actually express what was the level of this dehumanization. And at that point, it was again necessary to think what is actually that we have there, and also to think about the conceptual apparatus with which actually to grasp the horrors of the refugee camps and all what was going on. So back in 2007, 2008, some years after, Achille Mbembe, the African philosopher, actually coined the term necropolitics, what means this biopolitics, what means this necropolitics, why to go back, and I think necropolitics is really the point to understanding this global capitalism in which we live. So just briefly, biopolitics, it's actually this famous term by Foucault, in which actually is always the articulation of contemporary, at that time, capitalist societies from the so-called politics of life, where life does not matter anymore. It was by Agamben said, it's bare life on the other party's life for forms, but definitely life in biopolitics is seen as the zero degree of intervention of each and every politics in contemporary societies. But in 2003, Achille Mbembe actually coined necropolitics. He is discussing the new logic of the capital and its processes of geopolitical demarcation of the world zones based on mobilization of the war machine. This is definitely after the 2001, that is a big entrance of global capitalism on the world scene. Necropolitics is the outcome of what's going on at that point still and in relation to Africa. Mbembe claims that the concept of biopolitics due to the war machine and the state of exception being one of the major logics of the contemporary society should be replaced with necropolitics. And necropolitics is practically connected to the concept of necrocapitalism and also necropower. So a contemporary capitalism which organizes its form of capital accumulation and involves dispossession and the subjection of life to the power of death. So this is why this relation between life and death is central for all the processes also for capital discrimination, racializations that we are actually witnessing in the last decade in a really pregnant form. But what is this biopolitics? I coined biopolitics schematically as the text is, going back to Foucault. And biopolitics actually, if we think the 70s and 80s, the 70s are the right moment, practically biopolitics can be designed between this term of life, bio, politics taking care of life or managing life, and I put this axiomatic moment, make life and let die. So the very good case is actually, today is this big event of the 25 years of unification, but practically make live and let die, it's a super description of this second world, this Europe that doesn't, Eastern Europe, that doesn't exist anymore, because in the 70s, make live was actually a good life for the Western world, first capitalist world in Europe, and what was going on the other side, nobody care. So let die, it was not maybe an intervention, but it's actually this description, or in some other parts of the world, in the third world and so on. So this is the biopolitical. On the other hand, with necropolitics, we had another governmentalities, politics of necro, and necro is death in Latin. So, practically, again, the question is how to think about the necropolitics in relation to biopolitics and see how necropolitics is excellent for the time that we live. So the definition, the same as it was with biopolitics, I said, maybe we can think about necropolitics in the obverse. So let live and make die. And if you think between make live and let live, it's a big difference. Let live is practically an abandoning. You can live if you have measures, if not, it's your business. And make die is practically the investment of the machinery of war that we see presently going on and really governing death and not life. I also actually, in this reading, it's possible to say, those who are into this field of research, that practically the way of description of necropolitics, what Mbembe is suggesting, can be seen, this let live and make die, something very old in a certain way, because let live and make die is, going back to Foucault, a kind of a passé, almost form of governmentality. It applies precisely to the feudal society of sovereignty. So something before even the biopolitical that was discovered by Foucault. That is important thing. So practically, how is possible to say something so passé is what I term is definitely the way how life and death, so this necropolitical is actually the way of governmentality of life and death in neoliberal global capitalism. I say that this is possible because, opposed to thanatopolitics, necropolitics is a mode of life that actually take the war machine and make the co-property of power and capital together, but in the way that superimpose this necropolitical take over the biopower, over this governmentality of life, and we see and we get a situation in which practically we don't have just biopolitics and necropolitics, that we have a case living one near the other, so the refugees in the cities or somewhere near the station and the good life in places like this where we witness to theory, discussion and so on, but it's even more the necropolitically superimposed and regulating the biopower. This superimposition was this kind of the feudal sovereign city was actually already put as a possibility in 1990 by Deleuze in his seminal text Postscript on the Societies of Control. He said this can be the case, so not the repetition of some conditions after this period, but actually a kind of coming back of the society of sovereignty in the most developed point, and this is global capitalism. And he said how we will see this characterization of this feudal system, of this let live and make die. The characteristic were two, mainly, to tax rather than organize production, to rule on death rather than to administer life. Practically, these two elements are very much present in today's global world. So we can say that this one of the questions, can the present be conceived as a pre-war period? Definitely, we see that this coming back is not just a minimal difference, but has what I call a tectonic difference to understand the system in global capitalism. Also, in Foucault triad of power, it's this sovereign disciplinary, sovereign, then the disciplinary and the bio, so to say, specially and historical contingent way, how actually the power is going on. So from the feudal period is the disciplinary society after that, and then it's the bio society. And for each of these societies to understand precisely this return, we can actually think what are the, for the sovereignty, what is the model of societal relationship according to, let's say, some illness, something that actually will give us a very simple way how to understand this. So in the analysis that is put forward, it said that we can understand the sovereign model, this model before the discipline and the bio, in relations to the way of managing to a case of leprosy. So the lepers in the sovereign society, they were actually completely removed from the society. This was the only way how to regulate this. On the other hand, Stanescu, who is making the discipline, and he's very much into understanding the biopolitical, and as I said, might point is to go from this biopolitical always one step farther. So to understand what are these emblematic situations for the necropolitical. So he said leprosy for the sovereign society, the feudal time, complete isolation you have in all the film. The second point is what is then the emblematic way of regulation for the society of discipline. And he said, in the society of discipline, in the shift toward the biopolitical society, has actually plague as the emblematic illness. And there, it's only the regulation in the space, not in this way of, so to say, exclusion, in order just to prevent the contagion. So what is then the condition of for the necropolitical time in which we live? How this sovereignty and these exclusions is actually coming back? And I said the one of the best cases for us is definitely the outbreak of Ebola. When the outbreak of Ebola happened in Africa 2 years ago, so not even, maybe a year or two in the past, what we had, what was the way? First, it was all these bigger newspaper kind of titles, the failure to actually deal with Ebola. Then it was also the big titles like world leaders failing to help over Ebola outbreak in Africa. But what was the outcome of this? How to understand really the necropolitical here in the present time? It was that the whole continent of Africa was actually transformed in the leprosy continent. What this means, it was a cordon sanitaire. While in the US, in the European Union, especially in the European Union, measures were being taken of the maximum regulation of spaces, bodies and all the most sophisticated pharmaceutical and technological achievements were brought to the public in the health sectors by multinationals. So we see immediately what was seen impossible coming back from this, what was actually seen as necropolitical, as an old way of description, what is the relations between death and life. So the point that Stanescu also make is that Foucault practically said that in this, and he also thought about these things, but he was only developing, and I repeat, biopolitics for the first world, for the Western world, where life was something that you nurture and so on. But he said that in all these situations of the way of exclusion and also what will press onto the biopower, onto the biopower of the First World War, he said will be always the racial moment. The racial moment will be there. And also he said racism will be very much put out of the talk. So Foucault is actually talking that and saying, and Stanescu onto this, that the biopolitical is made onto the fear of racial impurity that remains the basis of the biopower and biopolitics. And part of this is also what is possible to see, a kind of a state racism, as stated by Stanescu also, that produce fears about how races will mix. And this is some of the elements that we see also in the way of regulation of the refugees in the present moment. Therefore, a variety of controls are created precisely in order to regulate populations. What we have at all times are powers' reactions to fears of contamination. This is what stays. In necropolitics, that is always a culmination of biopolitics, we clearly see this superimposition of the fear of racial impurity in the way the refugee camps are managed. Again, if you go back to what was going on in August when the shock started, and after that now it's completely necropolitically normalized, it was reported that refugees were locked in a stadium for nearly 24 hours at the islands in Kos, in Greece, and also that mostly of them, these 2,500 and many more, were actually completely confiscated, seized there, but also the procedures of closures and outcasts were very violently forced and put onto them. Stanescu also stated that what we see in analyzing biopolitics is not something positive, but rather a decision taken of what is not. This is also the definition that is coming of rethinking precisely what was left out from Foucault. And what this means, not a white body, not our civilization. This is what actually is the darker side of the biopolitical. And Roberto Esposito, making definitely only the relations to biopolitics, he still stays on this moment of immunization. So he said it's about immunity. But Stanescu make one step further. He said, if we think about immunization, this what is not, to make like a cordon sanitaire, to draw a line, he said practically every immunity carries the risk of autoimmunity with it. And what this means, in medicine, when an otherwise healthy immune system becomes confused and starts attacking healthy cells, it is referred to as an autoimmune disorder. And the result of this now change of politics between this immunity, but actually going into an autoimmunity is, quote, two identified co-supplementary movements of the biopolitical, both inherently violent and imperialist. One is a move of rendering someone as inhuman and therefore disposable, and the other is a move of rendering someone as human and therefore in need of training and eradicating all traces of the inhuman. Both of these procedures are clearly present in their ultimate invigorated format as part of what we have in the refugee camps, for example, in European Union in this moment. The autoimmunization presents the forms of control as the refugee camps are managed onto racism or onto racial purity. This is the role of biopower in the necropolitical settings of the refugees camp. So yes, biopower, but inside the necropolitical. So I come to my second point, the consequences for our conceptualization of life and death, because this has directly the consequences for what matters the most, what means, what is actually life, and what kind of life, and what kind of death. In the light of these arguments, the refugee camps are not simply the state of exception, but a place to see the processes of autoimmunization in order to get rid of those not human. On the other hand, the idea of seclusion is based on racism, as the idea of racial purity remains central to security at the camp. Those inhuman are, of course, though presented as natural, meticulously constructed as such. The construction is very at the basis, the logic of why we have this differentiation. First, what comes across as striking is that when biopolitics is framed differently, we see the insufficiency of biopolitics as a frame to rethink the refugee camp. The refugee camp, as it's said and presented in public discourse, is for the protection of human rights. This is how it's said. But we clearly see in the last 2 years and before that systematically, but in less obvious manner, that the camp is a place of dehumanization. Furthermore, it's also connected to a different status of life and consequently death. I want to name the life in the refugee camp not by using the usual rhetoric, but by using a new category that was actually part of the title of the text by Stanescu, with which I started, and this is deading life. Deading life is a procedure employed to suppress, diminish, impoverish, and ruin life, but is not death. This is really important. So this is not just life or death. It's in the process, it's a procedure, but still is not death. Stanescu states that if we take seriously Foucault's claim that biopolitics is about politics taking life itself as its object, then the obvious question rises, what is life? In the strange tension between biopolitics and thanatopolitics, that we actually said is not our business, and we are not interested in this, we seem to be presented with a theoretical buffet, like in the morning in the good hotel you have a buffet. with which to explore and understand what politicized life means. And he actually gave an interesting line, because it's all about histories, historized ways of thinking about life. It's about actually a way of thinking what was produced. So he's saying, here is the list. Agamben, bare life; Judith Butler, precarious life; Walter Benjamin, mere life; Balibar's, disposable life; Eugene Tucker, afterlife; Timothy Campbell, improper life; and Deleuze, a life. We cut with this, and we said, let's think about the refugee and also about our life in this relation, because this is connected as deading life. Stănescu also connects this notion of deading life with a changed view on death. He quotes Primo Levi, who wrote that for certain victims of the extermination camp, one hesitates to call their death as death. And what is more, he makes an important reference to Arendt, who, traumatized by what was seen in the extermination camps, stated that what shocked the conscience was not just the death, not just the amount of death, but how it was done. She referred to it as a fabrication of corpses. Therefore, Stănescu states, death that we hesitate to call death. Where else is there an engagement with the production and fabrication of corpses? End of quotation. In another key point, Stănescu argues that compared to the other conception of forms of life, and now I put the list that I quoted before, all this list that is not just a list, this is not a description, these are new conditions of how to think about life. And to understand what are the processes, to understand the tectonic differences between what seems just a small minimal difference. So what makes deading life different is that life isn't left alone, let to die in the language of Foucault. It's not the case, but instead it is thoroughly fabricated and artificial. Deading life is not simply death, as it's possible to think when we see the conditions in the refugee camps. And it is not life that is living, but a process and precursor to death. Life is but an added element to an end product, death. One of the most important elements that is part of deading life that is exposed by Stănescu is a sense of life meant as pure production, as pure use value. This is actually this deading of life that is really paradoxical. Use value of life in time of global capitalism. Why this is so perplexing? As we know that everything what's going on in capitalism is connected to exchange value. But what is present in relation to the refugees is a complete veto on the possibility that all these people enter the labor market to become, as all of us from the EU, exchange value. Those who get the job are not coming as refugees, but through what is termed the needs of the diversified labor market as a high-skilled labor force and so on. What was the main demand, I asked myself, when the refugee protest camp and many other refugee protests that we forgot already started in 2012? Because there exists a history to what we have here, a short one, but very dense. To work, this was the demand, to become self-sufficient, and while some other demands by the refugees, at least in Vienna, were negotiated, the entrance into the labor market was out of the discussion. Therefore, Stănescu asks if there has ever been a more complete and thorough realization of Marx's surplus population than the factory farm. With this in mind, I will universalize this question and ask, according to Achille Mbembe and others, if there has ever been a complete superfluous population, as is in the case with the refugees in Europe, that are prevented to work and forced to live a life that is not death, but thoroughly fabricated use value, a deading life. So I come now to the third point, visibility and humanity. Furthermore, what is going on in the refugee camps is a visible topic in the mass media and online. And this is also something that is different, because we see it's every day. It's if it's not, if it's in a prime news for 5 minutes. Estanesco asks, what are the visual machines that are part of different power technologies? Again, just briefly, for the sovereign power, the technology that was present as the optical technologies was the guillotine, cutting the head, then the society of discipline used in a panopticon as a technology of power, and there was actually this managing of life. This was very present as a technology, as something very visible. And this managing of life was also managing of health and the population. But if we think that this is the characteristic of the society of discipline in going into biopolitics, that this was the case, we actually have to change our mind, at least when we start to think of the darker side of the whole period that Foucault described, and this is when we take into consideration colonialism. Because colonialism is not only what Edward Said has named a pact between anthropocentrism and Eurocentrism, but furthermore a project of dispossession and again dehumanization by capitalism covered by a veil of humanity. That is, as another theoretician, Aimé César, said, and I quote, a sordidly racist concept, or even more, a pseudo-humanism. And if we think that the whole idea of biopolitics is about this humanity, to give, as I said, to the first world, the humanity, the good condition of life, so if the main characteristics of the biopolitical is a pseudo-humanism, and if it's clear that the human is always a constructed concept against the background of racism, I will state that the optical machine of necropolitics, and I repeat, Stanescu just working with biopolitics, so that the optical machine of necropolitics is actually the post-human. So not humanity, but actually something after, the post-human. Or if biopolitics resides in colonialism and its pseudo-humanism, this is the other obverse side of this biopolitical, I claim that necropolitics resides in coloniality. And coloniality is the new form of colonialism. It's a present coloniality. It's not directly, it's connected with colonialism, but is for the time that we live. And it's post-humanism. Both are constructed on a racial foundation, but their rhetoric is different. And what is this difference? How we actually come to this difference between biopolitics and between necropolitics and the questions of humanity, pseudo-humanity and the post-human? It follows that the biopolitical production of the human does not seek to just make the human exceptional in relationship to all other animals, which is itself a problematic position, but seeks a humanity that cannot be reducible to the human animal. This is the difference in biopolitics. Or, in the words of a new feminist materialist position, like Rosie Braidotti, it desires a human that is more than human. But here is as well a difference at stake regarding the point, depending if we talk of biopolitics and necropolitics. In biopolitics, the demand is more human than human, to produce a humanity that is disconnected from the finitude of humanity's very real animality. And one of these cases is this film Blade Runner from the 80s, precisely about the biopolitics. You have there these replicants, androids, with superhuman abilities that are almost interchangeable with humans, except for one test. This test measured a person's empathy, particularly its empathy toward other animals. But if we make a recurse to what new materialism is developed presently, more human than human, we see that it's still not enough. As more, to this, if human, if this idea too human, much too human, if we come to this point, we see actually the difference. The biopolitical was always about what is written here, this dream, more human than human. This was the dream. But what is the difference with necropolitics? Necropolitical injunction, that means a forced implication is that what the neoliberal global capitalism wants to do is still too human. And to understand these two points means that the optical machine of necrocapitalism can't tolerate any class, race, or transgender specificities. That means that practically the post-human, if it's still, the injunction is still too human, must actually evade, and we have all these discourses about the post-human and all these discourses about how to evade from this humanity, because otherwise it's all these implications, as I said, class, race, transgender specificity, that are coming back. They implicate the return of crash, of harsh class antagonism, and also this implicates racialization and genderization as part of the post-human. And this is absolutely not the case. This is what has to be prevented. And just to show the implication, what this even more means for this separation between biopolitics and necropolitics, regarding the positions that we live, our, let's say, citizenship, and also the situation that we have in this present moment in Europe. If we go back and make again the reference to Stănescu, he talks about the genocide in the extermination camp. He makes always this relation, because for us this is the most important point historically. And he said, in relation to Arendt, in the extermination camp, we don't have any sign of humanity left. Holocaust resides on the complete erasure of any sign of existence of the human body as such. Any document that will connect the Jew in the Nazi extermination camps with humans have to be destroyed, to the point where the body and the human to which it belongs are to be completely erased, nullified, incinerated. It is important to state that we do not have photographs of the extermination genocide itself, and those few taken were taken under a direct threat of death by those who still believed in memory and history. As revealed by Arendt, it is especially important that the prerogative of citizenship was violently taken from the Jews as part of this violent racist anti-Semitism. This is really important historical to understand the way how actually the process was put forward, on which elements it resides behind, and what was the law context. But what is the difference today, and why it's not possible to make just an equation between extermination camps and refugee camps? The violent effect of the substitution of biopolitics by necropolitics, that on which I stand, is evident in the process of granting citizenship. And I think the 1st of October, when it was the beginning of this session, Michel Fer made this relation. He actually was putting forward different cases of the status of refugee. And maybe you will remember he also went to this case, but only in the description. He said, let's think about the first moment when the conscience for humanity of Europe stood up, and this was actually the Lampedusa case, October 12, 2013. 350 refugees from Africa drowned in a single day. Alarm. They were drowning every day. The last decade, 10, 12, this was normal in the necropolitical. One day, 350, and it's the end. Like those following the Deleuze would say, this was just an additional crystallization of the alarming scale of the refugee crisis in the EU, which is actually happening in every day and also is going on for a decade. But what is this difference, the biopolitical and necropolitical? How to apply, and we don't stay only in these descriptions, but we think about the logic, what was happening actually, and this is my interest. Still, I say the most perverse situation happened afterwards, when the hundreds of dead bodies were given Italian citizenship. This was also said, but only in order for the Italian government and the EU to bury them in Italy. That was obviously cheaper than sending the dead bodies back to their countries of origin and to their respective families. And I don't know if you remember, when they declared these 350 corpses, they are Italian citizens, precisely why they were coming to Europe. But at that point, they were not granted this. But when they were dead, they were granted this. And it was even said that all the others who are still alive, they will actually be prosecuted because they infringed the law of the EU. The Italian government decided to prosecute the only few others that survived. And this was very interesting to think what this citizenship meant for us going on last year. What this means for the whole idea of citizenship also historically. For me, this is the clear sign of the perverse and violent new attitude that Western Europe has toward human rights. After the West has been for decades heavily capitalizing its democracy on it, it was all about protection of human rights. And the occurrence in that moment of a new category of citizenship, and this is a necropolitical citizenship, giving to this corpse 350 the citizenship was not just any citizenship. That means it was just a new history in the whole idea. This was a necropolitical citizenship. The colonial racial division is applied to citizenship. This is what we have from this history. And we have two categories of citizenship. One is the category of biopolitical citizenship. This is the EU natural nation-state citizens. And the other is the necropolitical citizenship, given to refugees and sans-papier after they die on EU soil. Thank you.